started, I like to be an on-time person, so we do have a... Yeah, I got my thumbs up over there. That's right. We like to start on time, and I try and honor to finish on time as well. So I do have a lot of content tonight for y'all, especially with the subject as complicated as hormones. I'm sure you could appreciate the fact that we had to whittle it down to the nuts and bolts as much as possible tonight. So, last time we did hormone workshop last year, if you recall, if you're around then, we did more of a hormone overview. We talked about all the different hormonal systems, but we didn't really get that much in depth for them. Today we're going to take a little bit of a different approach, and what we're going to do is talk about a few very key hormones, the ones that usually are the ones that people have problems with the most, but we're going to take a lot more depth in each one of those areas. Is that cool? And so then I'm going to teach you the problems that can commonly go wrong with these particular hormonal systems. We're going to talk about the adrenal glands down here, right? We're going to talk about the thyroid. We're going to talk about estrogen. We're going to talk about testosterone. And you know, we're going to be getting into how to actually solve these issues and what symptoms you may be having if you're dealing with any of these particular hormones. So a couple logistical things. Make sure you got your workshop validation card punched if you're tracking that. Also, each one of you should have received some papers from a very cute 8-year-old girl back there. Okay, that is my daughter, Hannah, which she wanted me to mention that she got third place at her gymnastics meet. She's very proud of that. So if you've ever heard me tell Hannah's story, there she is in the flesh in real life. So a chiropractic miracle story from birth, right? So here's what we're going to be going through tonight for you guys, and then we do have a sale on some products as well. We just ask that if you are planning to order those, and this is only redeemable through the workshop here tonight, so that's your reward for attending, so thank you for being here. And then you can redeem this for the team members, and then you can pick up your products in the office, because many of these we don't stock. We order them on a case-by-case basis, and I will tell you that when it comes to hormones, many times I encourage patients to test, don't guess. Let's test and find out exactly what hormone disruption we're dealing with so that we can make sure we get it fixed. Because can you agree there's nothing more frustrating than thinking you're doing something to solve a problem only to find out that you're actually doing the wrong thing to solve that problem? Yeah, that's kind of frustrating. So we want to make sure that you guys get the best results with the products that you're going to be receiving. But if you already have a diagnosed thyroid issue or a diagnosed testosterone issue, I am going to be going through some solutions for that so you can get started on these protocols immediately if you know for sure that's what you're dealing with. So, okay, let's get into it here tonight. I don't even think I opened up with a good evening and checked in on you guys. So, good evening.
Good evening.
All right. Well, welcome. It's good to see everybody out again. Even on the rainy day, we had some challenges with, apparently they have a funeral going on today as well. And so here we are in the basement, but we're all together. It's a little muggy down here, and you know, whatever. We're going to make this happen tonight, right? So, all right. Some of you may find this comical. Some of you that are going through this or have been through this phase of life will not find this very funny because you've been there. But I'm still hot. It just comes in flashes now. And just shows how much our hormones can really take control of our entire body when we don't want them to necessarily, right? And so if you've been through that rite of passage as a female, then you know what this one's all about, right? So tonight, what we're going to do is, it is a crazy oversimplified version of hormones, yet it's still, just because the nature of hormones, still going to be a bit complicated. So please try and track with me as best as you can. We're going to ask that you save your questions till the end. So if you have something, go ahead and write it down. I'll be happy to field that at the end. And then the goal is to understand the complexity, harmony, yet the beauty of how there's this balance going on inside of the body. If you've ever heard me talk about hormones before, I talk about hormones being like a symphony, right? And if everything's in balance, the symphony sounds beautiful. It's a pleasure to listen to. It's for everyone to enjoy, right? But when even one instrument is out of tune or that person plays the wrong note, then it sticks out like a sore thumb and it can ruin the entire orchestra, it can ruin the entire experience, right? Same thing is true with the hormones. It really only takes one to to go awry to throw the rest of the system off, and that's why it can be a little bit of a complicated issue. Understand the importance of lifestyle changes in properly regulating hormonal balance, and then why and what supplements are necessary to balance the hormones. And that's often true. These issues are complicated enough that it's very difficult oftentimes to fix them with just lifestyle changes and food alone. Usually there is an underlying nutritional deficiency or a level of toxicity that needs to be addressed to bring the hormones back into balance. Simple lifestyle modifications that really work, and then how chiropractic is one of the best kept secrets for helping to balance hormones. And we're going to talk about that very briefly tonight as well. So, our beautiful endocrine system. Endocrine system is the system that controls all the hormonal responses inside of our body. And so the ones that we're going to talk about primarily, right, you can see over here we have our thyroid gland, sits right there in the neck. We have our adrenal glands here, adrenal meaning kidney, it sits right up there positioned on top of the kidney, right? Pretty cool. We're going to talk about how there's hormones secreted through the reproductive system as well. That'll be our estrogen and testosterone and things of that nature. And then also the master regulator, the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland. And that's going to be one of our connections to chiropractic care, and I'm going to show you the link. But that upstream dysfunction can be the result of a myriad of different hormonal dysfunctions. So if you don't have that corrected first, I've seen patients chase, you know, one hormonal problem after the next with different supplements or different therapies or protocols, maybe even hormonal creams. We're going to talk about some of the symptomatic things that patients typically get into with this and how that may not be your best option as well. So here's our hormonal system at a glance. The first one that we're going to get into is the adrenal glands. Again, those little glands that sit right here on top of the head. Two very small glands, considered the stress handling glands. So when you're too stressed out and your body's not adapting to stress very well, you may have an adrenal dysfunction. And the adrenal gland produces a hormone called cortisol. It also produces another hormone called DHEA. It produces epinephrine and norepinephrine, and it also helps to regulate and coordinate with other hormones. Remember that symphony, that balance that we talked about, right? The vitality of this depends on the strength and the health of your adrenal gland. So this is very, very affected by stress. Stress is one of the biggest factors in adrenal overload. And you can have two different forms of primary adrenal dysfunction. You can have adrenal fatigue, which is 80% of people. We'll get into that in a second. You can also have another level, which is adrenal exhaustion. And that's where you've had adrenal fatigue for a really long time, that it actually just causes your adrenal glands to basically collapse. And then there's one level that's even deeper than that, which is called adrenal burnout. And that's where the adrenal gland just completely fails. And so hopefully nobody's in that stage. Really, it would be difficult to even get out of bed or have the energy to do anything at that phase. But most of these symptoms and most of what people experience is actually the adrenal fatigue. So that's the one that we're going to most focus on. So what affects adrenal fatigue and the cortisol production? Stress, overwork, not enough vacation, chronic emotional issues. Does that describe anyone else? All right. Yeah, a little bit of stress in life out there. Nutrient deficiencies. Nutrition plays a role in almost everything, so that one should be fairly obvious, right? Lack of sleep, and there's something very interesting about sleep and its relationship to the adrenal glands. Less than 7 hours, more than 4 to 5 nights a week. But you're going to see here in a minute that you'll actually feel better if you sleep for a really long night. If that boosts your energy up, then that also is a sign of adrenal dysfunction, as you'll see. Lack of sleep, restless nights, yeah, that's definitely a telltale sign for adrenal issues. Blood sugar issues, insulin resistance, having low blood sugar, food sensitivities, IgG or IgA lab tested, low-grade infections, so if you're always seeking to get infections or you have periodontal, you know, a gum infection when you go in and get checked by the dentist, if you're having gut dysbiosis, so you're swinging all the way from, you know, loose stools to thick stools and back and forth, and you just really can't get good regulation, you're not having good frequency or quantity of bowel movements, that's gut dysbiosis in a nutshell. Candida overgrowth and H. pylori. So there are some other bacterial infections that can throw off the adrenal glands as well. One that I found that was really interesting when I was studying and researching this is prolonged workouts. If you actually work out consistently for over 30 minutes, that in and of itself can start to wear and tear on the adrenal glands. And in fact, the cortisol production that occurs after 30 minutes of workout, it has some interesting effects on your body. Number one, stress. Number two, it actually decreases your immune system function, which I thought was really interesting. And then it inhibits your ability to recover. So I thought those were all really interesting findings, and that's one of the reasons why we recommend the high-intensity workouts with what we do. So it's short duration, right, 10 to 15 minute total workouts, but really high intensity. And that really seems to help avoid this cortisol secretion and helps keep the adrenal glands healthy. And then there's also an autoimmune response that can occur as well, and something that's called leaky gut syndrome. Leaky gut syndrome is a whole workshop in and of itself. We did that workshop a few months ago. If you need to review that, you could go to my YouTube channel. If you want to watch last year's hormone workshop and get the overview, you can go to the YouTube channel and watch that as well. So we're not going to get into leaky gut too much. Just know that's an extremely important factor to consider in the overall health of the adrenal glands and getting them back. So 44% of Americans feel more stressed than they did 5 years ago. How many of you would say that that's true for yourself? Just raise your hand for me. Yeah, so at least half the room is raising their hand. Pretty interesting, right? It's amazing how much the stress just seems to build more and more and more and accumulate over time. And the problem is that once your adrenal glands are insufficiently producing the right hormones and insufficiently balanced, then there's this snowball effect of stress. Does that make sense? Like you find yourself on a hair trigger, you can't handle the same amount of stress that maybe you could 5 years ago or 10 years ago. Right? That's an adrenal gland issue. So overview of this low cortisol and adrenal fatigue and DHEA balances, which is really what we're dealing with. We talked about the immune system suppression that causes. Increased allergies and infections. So you find out that, you know, a lot of people will see their allergies increase, you know, a lot of times during this time of the year, and they say, oh, you know, seasonal allergies, that kind of stuff. But let's think about what's going on right now. I know this has been a stressful transition for my family. We just went from summer to school year, right? Does anybody find that stressful besides myself? You got new routines. You got to get the kids up earlier. You got to get homework done at night, right? There's just a lot of these extra balls that you got to juggle, right? And so, you know, trying to keep up with all of that stuff, extra stress, dips the adrenal gland function down. There you go. You know, you get increased allergies as a result of that. So it doesn't necessarily have as much to do with the season or the environmental pollens or things like that. It could just be for the sheer fact that we're under more stress here. What's another time of the year that we typically see a heightened level of stress? Yes, during the holiday season, that Christmas season can be extremely stressful. You're shopping for gifts, you're hosting family, you're going to parties, you're eating things that you probably wouldn't otherwise eat throughout the rest of the year. You know, all the sugar-loaded stuff, right? Extra stress on the body. So again, immune system's down. This is what they call the flu season, right? It really has nothing to do with all of a sudden there's this flu bug out there that decided to rear its ugly head and start infecting people, right? The flu bug, I guarantee you that virus has no idea what time of the year it is. Okay? I guarantee you. It has no idea what time of the year it is. It doesn't say, oh, you know what? Everybody's going to school and now, you know, Christmas is almost coming. We should really start infecting people to make their life miserable during this happy time of year, right? It just has to do with the fact that we're overstressed, our immune systems are suppressed because we're not paying attention to this stuff. And does that make sense, guys? Okay, and then now you're susceptible to the infection, you're susceptible to that virus. So is the flu shot the answer then?
No,
that's not the answer. The answer would be, let's fix these susceptibilities, strengthen up our adrenal glands, make sure that our energy levels, our exercise levels, make sure we're living this lifestyle correctly. That's gonna allow us to kind of hum through this season. And there's research that I've shown to you guys before that shows, you know, if you're just taking even minimal amounts of vitamin D3, you know, 2,000 to 5,000 units a day, that's more effective. God bless you. That's more effective than any flu shot, you know, ever has been. So, okay. Another sign of low cortisol and adrenal issues: mornings are really rough, and evenings are better. So, those of you that say I'm not a morning person, right, could be a telltale sign of adrenal issues. Sleep problems, typically waking up around 2 a.m. So if you wake up around 2 to 3 a.m. seemingly for no reason except for that you're just awake, that could be another sign. So if you're just kind of checking off the boxes here saying, yep, that's me. The opposite of that is if you get a really long night's sleep, we're talking like 12, 14, 16 hours in a night, and that actually makes you feel refreshed. Because the normal human response, unless you've just been sleep deprived for, you know, the time leading up to that, the normal human response, if you sleep that long, you actually wake up tired. Have you ever done that before? You just overslept. You just got lazy a day. It happens, right? And you just feel groggy and tired a little bit. That's the normal human response to that. If you have that much amount of sleep and you actually feel up, you know, refreshed and ready to take on the day, that's another sign of adrenal dysfunction. Reducing memory recall and cognitive function. So you walk into a room and you forget why you walked into the room. That's what we call brain fog, right? And again, that can be an adrenal dysfunction. Lack of stamina, increased muscle loss, bone loss, mood problems, decreased libido, and digestive imbalances. So again, a lot of connections there to different systems in the body. Here's the basic treatment protocol. Two steps primarily. You gotta remove the stress, and you gotta nourish the adrenals. Seems fairly simple, right? How easy is it practically to remove stress though? Right, that can be tough. So we nourish the adrenals, and we try and manage the stress as much as humanly possible. So you wanna look at all the different factors that can come into stresses coming in your body, psychological, physical, biochemical stressors. So we can eliminate some of these, right? We can try and eliminate some of the physical stresses. Let's cut our exercise routine down to the high intensity version. Let's eliminate any unnecessary chemicals that are coming in contact with our body. That can help to minimize some of the stress. You may not be able to change your work environment or your home environment or what some of the other stressors may be, but the ones that you can control, let's do that. And then nourish the adrenal glands. So we're gonna go through some specific adrenal supplementation here. Supplementation dosage based on how severe the adrenal exhaustion is. So that would really be dependent on your case specifically. But what happens then is if you're not addressing both of these, then you can end up getting caught in this cycle here. And that's why I put it in a circular format, because if you're not addressing both, you can really never get yourself out of that cycle the way that you need to for them to recover. So you could be nourishing the adrenal glands, but if there's still a ton of stress coming in, then you're still gonna stay trapped in that adrenal fatigue process. You could be removing the stress, but the adrenals have already been fatigued out. Your body can't assimilate the nutrients and get enough nourishment to them. You could be trapped in that cycle for a lot longer than you otherwise should. So I've had patients where it's taken them up to a year and a half, 2 years to recover from adrenal exhaustion. So that would be the second phase of it. So you really do want to catch this. If you think this is you, you want to catch it in the adrenal fatigue. It's a lot easier to fix in that phase than it is to let it go into the other phases. So remove the stress. How do you do that? Let's make sure you're sleeping adequately. Prayer, meditation, and breathing exercises to help bring it down. That's going to help manage some of the stress. No dietary changes or supplements will help you fully recover if you don't address the stress. And that's that loop that we were talking about. Stress equals gut distress. So again, there's the leaky gut factor and the gut dysbiosis factor, which we don't necessarily have time to get into fully tonight, but I want you to know that is a critical component of this. So don't just think that you can take some of the supplements that I'm recommending tonight. If you have a gut issue, that needs to be addressed as well, okay? And then step number two, nourishing the adrenals. So here's how we get the adrenals to heal with some specific supplementation. There's two that I love for the adrenal fatigue phase. And again, this is phase one. This is 80% of people that have adrenal issues usually land in this phase. The first one is the GA. That's an adrenal supplement that we special order now in the offices. It helps to support, stimulates the brain by supporting the production of dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine. These are the primary hormones that DHA and cortisol are derived from or synergistic with. So you need to have a balance of all of those different hormonal production. Includes herbal support through rhodiola. Rhodiola rolls is a really powerful adaptogen, and this helps your body be able to adapt to the stresses that, you know, are put on your body day in and day out. So powerful adaptogen increases the body's resistance to biological and chemical stresses. Tyrosine is a cortisol regulator. helps with concentration and focus. So we talked about that brain fog issue. These include that. So the adrenal, the GA, which is the adrenal functional, adrenal support, and then energy. If there's energy issues that are associated with that, then I add in the adrenal energy.
Is tyrosine a protein?
Tyrosine is a protein derivative, SPM. Adrenal healing phase two. So those that have the next level of adrenal problem, then we need to, instead of the adrenal energy, we actually have to add the adrenal calm. And that will help to calm the adrenal glands. It takes a lot of sleep, honestly, so you have to make sure that you're very, very regimented with your sleep patterns, that you're getting to bed early, because that's what, you know, every hour that you get to bed before midnight is almost like your body registers it as 2 hours worth of the quality of sleep that you get. So really the earlier that you can get to bed before midnight, the better the hormonal response that you're going to get as a result of that. But for those of you that have gotten into the phase two or think you might be in the phase two, the adrenal exhaustion phase, this will help to calm the brain, because a lot of times these patients will describe themselves being wired and tired at the same time. So go, 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 feel like they can never fully shut it down, but then when they do try and go to sleep at night, then they just keep going and going and going, right? So if you have that sensation, that can be an adrenal issue as well. We need to calm the brain, we need to calm the mind, calm the adrenal glands down so that you can get a good quality restful night's sleep and actually recover. Okay, the thyroid gland. So adrenal gland, lots of fun there, right? Does that make sense? A lot of stuff going on there. That was really loaded and packed with a lot of information. Thyroid gland. Take a look at how the thyroid gland works. You have the hypothalamus, which is right up here in the base of the brainstem. And so that's the part that's surrounded and protected by that very top bone in your spine. This is one of the reasons why that's such an important area to make sure it's aligned. And I'm going to show you all the areas that addresses and that connects to in the rest of your body. So the hypothalamus produces thyrotropin hormone, which is what stimulates the thyroid gland. So, that stimulates the pituitary gland. The pituitary then produces thyroid stimulating hormone, which is what actually stimulates the thyroid gland to then produce T3, T4, and calcitonin. Okay, now T3 is the active version of the thyroid hormone. So some patients will have a conversion issue where the thyroid gland and the pituitary and the hypothalamus, that whole pathway is fine. They're just not converting T4 to T3 appropriately. Okay, there's a supplement that we could do for that. The problem with most medical testing is they don't test this whole feedback loop. They usually only test one. They only test the TSH. And the problem with that is that, you know, the biggest reason they do that is because their treatment protocol is the same no matter what. They put you on medication, right? They put you on Synthroid, okay? So it never really gets to the cause of the problem. They're just getting to the bottom line saying, hey, you're not getting enough T3. We're just going to put you on a synthetic version of T3. So that's just a chemical manipulation of the problem. It's, yeah, symptomatically, a lot of times that's going to help patients, but many times that doesn't solve the problem, right? Of course, it's not getting to the cause, so it's not going to solve the problem, right? And then what happens then is you actually become addicted to that medication. Because see right here where it says the negative feedback loop? So the more T3 and T4 that there is present in your bloodstream, so even if it's the synthetic version coming in from the medication, then that stimulates this negative feedback inhibition. So that inhibits the hypothalamus and the pituitary from producing these hormones that are needed for the thyroid gland to function correctly. So now you've actually caused a disruption in the normal hormone pathways and the normal hormone pattern, when that was never even the problem in the first place, you just had a conversion issue. Okay, so see how it's so important to make sure that you know exactly which step in the process isn't working correctly, to make sure that we're supplementing or that we're changing the lifestyle to fix that particular segment. Because there's a lot of steps to the conversion process. Does that make sense? Okay? So thyroid function, most extensive blood supply of all glands, that's pretty interesting, right? It sits right here in the throat, has the most extensive blood supply. So obviously that's a very active gland in the body because it has a lot of nutrient uptake coming in and out. But that also makes it one of the most susceptible glands to toxicity. So any toxicity exposure, guess what usually gets affected first by that? The thyroid gland. Why do you think so many people have thyroid issues in our country? You know, it is the most susceptible gland to having issues because it has this extensive blood supply. So almost everything passes through that thyroid gland because of the amounts of blood going through it. And it's responsible for regulating your body temperature, blood pressure, and metabolism. So one of the things that people with blood pressure issues commonly overlook is the thyroid issue. And so you could do all the cardiovascular testing, you could exercise, you could eat right. If your thyroid's not functioning correctly, it's going to be very difficult to get those blood pressure levels to regulate properly. Promotes normal development and function of the nervous system, the muscular system, and the skeletal system. Are those important systems in my profession? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is what I work with every single day, right? The neuromusculoskeletal system. Because, you know, we believe that if you keep the human frame properly aligned, then it allows better function for the rest of the organ systems in the body. Well, the thyroid is a critical component to that whole system, right? Promotes normal GI motility and tone. You've heard me talk so much about the health of the digestive system and how it plays a role in almost all these. There's a feedback role too, right? These organs also help to make sure the GI system stays healthy and well. Supports normal ovarian function. So again, that talks about that hormone orchestra and how they all play together. Promotes normal hydration of the skin. So if you're having really dry skin or overly hydrated skin, it could be a thyroid issue because your thyroid can be dysfunctional both ways. You can have an overactive thyroid or you can have an underactive thyroid. And those present completely differently based on what you have. So the basic needs of the thyroid, iodine, we talk about T3 and T4. T3 stands for triiodine. You know the triiodine? That means there's three iodines. T4 is four iodines within that hormone structure. And so iodine is a critical component to assimilate the hormones properly. But you also need magnesium and selenium. You would never want to take iodine supplementation alone for your thyroid. Please do not do that. That's dangerous. You do not want to do that. It needs to be combined with these other things to be properly assimilated, properly absorbed, and to make sure that it's not going to be interfering with other processes in the body. So magnesium and selenium are needed for proper uptake. Zinc, selenium, vitamin C, and vitamin B12 are critical for that T4 to T3 conversion that we talked about. Okay, so if you're just having problems with the conversion process at the end stage, and you're just taking a bunch of iodine because somebody told you that's what your thyroid needed, you could be overloading on iodine and it's still not going to be effective. Does that make sense? Okay, so you got to get the right part in the process. There's also something called subclinical hypothyroid, and this is also known as euthyroid or functional hypothyroidism. This is what I find most people with thyroid issues are actually at. This is the one I'm going to spend the most time on. The gland is fine, but the metabolic pathways are impaired. So a lot of times the patient will present with typical thyroid, dysfunctional thyroid symptoms, yet they don't have a dysfunctional thyroid test. So the testing, many blood tests are still typically normal. They don't have any testing issues. It has many of the same symptoms of an underactive thyroid, yet they've been tested for it, and no, my doctor said it's not my thyroid. It could still be the thyroid. It's just functional hypothyroidism. Many times this is a compensation for weak adrenal glands and the cortisol being too high. It's a result of estrogen dominance. So the whole cascade, that symphony, that harmony of all the other hormones definitely plays a role. So nutrient deficiencies can play into this as well. Again, iodine, selenium, magnesium, B12, all gonna be critical for that. What is Hashimoto's thyroiditis? Has anyone ever heard of this before? Yeah, Hashimoto's. This is the autoimmune version of thyroid issues. Remember how we talked about in the leaky gut workshop, the autoimmune, how it can attack different parts of the body, and one of those was the thyroid? That's what Hashimoto's is called. Okay, and that's the underactive version of an autoimmune condition. So, 60 to 80% of thyroid cases can be hypothyroid due to this autoimmune condition called Hashimoto's. It's rarely tested properly because, again, the treatment protocol is the same. Oh, your thyroid gland, or you're not getting enough T3, what are we gonna give you? Synthetic T3, right? We're just gonna give you that synthetic hormone. So the problem with that then is that you're never really addressing the cause, which is actually a gut issue that's causing that autoimmune response. So then what continues to happen to the gut? Does it get better or worse? It gets worse, and then it starts attacking other organs and tissues, maybe the joints or the nervous system. It starts causing more autoimmune issues in different parts of the body. So functioning and holistically, very specific protocols to fix these. Again, we talked about leaky gut in another seminar, so we don't have time to get into that in a lot of detail, but it is on my YouTube channel if you want to review that at home and learn the protocols to fix the gut. That's going to be absolutely critical in Hashimoto's. There are a couple other protocols I'm going to go through tonight that are the thyroid-specific part, because now the thyroid has been damaged by the autoimmune issue in the gut, right? So we do have to address both factors for it to heal properly. So thyroid healing. If it's the hypothyroid or the euthyroid, the functional hypothyroid that we talked about, you're going to take the GF, which is a thyroid support, functional thyroid support, and you're going to combine that with the TMI, which is thyroid metabolism plus iodine. So this has all the other cofactors that you're going to need, like the selenium and the magnesium and the B vitamins that we talked about, right? And then you would also take the GA, which again supports that conversion process from T4 to the active version of the hormone, which is the T3. So that is a good balance of iodine and iodide. You need both, you know, in order to get that functioning correctly. Now, if you do have Hashimoto's and you've been diagnosed with that autoimmune condition, you do not want to take the TMI. Okay, we've just seen that that has a negative response. You're going to fix the gut issues first. You would take the GF and the GA, but you would not take the TMI. Okay, however, if it's not Hashimoto's, you would want to take all three. Okay? Other nutrients to support the thyroid, iodine, again, you must combine it with selenium at a minimum. I would recommend that it also has the magnesium and the B vitamins as well, but never just take iodine alone. Foods that can increase iodine naturally, chicken, salmon, eggs, shiitake mushrooms, if you like those, right? Lamb and turkey. Again, quality is king when it comes to these. You want to make sure that you're getting whole food nutrition that comes from a good source. The last thing, again, because remember, what is the thyroid most susceptible to? Toxic interference. So if you're eating meats that are toxic, loaded up with other hormones and antibiotics, and they're not the organic meats that we promote, then you could be doing just as much harm as good at the same time. Does that make sense? Okay, so I'm not just trying to sell you on organic foods because I'm some hippie dude from the 60s that thinks we should all just eat organic and watch butterflies and flowers all day. No, I believe that, you know, you need organic foods because it has the least amount of chemicals and the highest nutrient content to actually be able to get you to heal correctly, okay? 1 to 2 Brazilian nuts a day for selenium. Avoid grains, gluten, and sugar. These all inhibit proper thyroid function. And then the gut healing food. So, you know, we have the whole protocol there, but this is just a brief summary. The fermented foods like sauerkraut are amazing for helping reestablish healthy gut gut interaction there, that gut biome that we talked about, the microbiome. Bone broth protein. How many of you tried the bone broth protein since then? You like it? That's pretty good stuff, huh? I found that to be very effective. And other fermented foods like kimchi, raw dairy is another great source. So again, very difficult sometimes to get your hands on some of these, especially like the raw dairy. But there are farmers out there, dairy farmers, that you can find this, you develop a relationship and get some trust going. You can get your hands on it, but you can definitely do this without that if you don't want to put that much homework into it. So.
Why does bone broth work?
Bone broth is just this ancient healing remedy for the gut. Yeah, it's just amazing. It helps to cultivate a natural, healthy gut microbiome. It helps to cultivate a healthy gut microbiome. You know, so it's really good for that. It's got a great source of healthy fats and the proteins in there, and the collagen and the bone broth.
So it's the same as if you made it from scratch, or soup, where you boil it until it makes a gel when it gets cold.
Yeah, and then they just dehydrate it and put it in. okay, leaky gut syndrome, we talked about that. I'm not, again, going to get into a ton about it, but it is super important, so I just wanted to give a quick reminder. Remember, stress plays an important role, toxins, abnormal food particles, medications, pathogens, and then if you have other, any other organ dysfunction. So one of those organ functions being the thyroid itself can contribute to part of this leaky gut issue. So GI inflammation, these food particles then slip through the gut, which eventually leads to an allergy or a food intolerance, and then down the line into an autoimmunity. How do you reverse that? You gotta fix the gut microbiome. So yeah, as Gene was saying, the bone broth is extremely healing for that. But then you also wanna be getting foods that have high amounts of probiotics, like the fermented foods, like the sauerkraut, to be taking a supplemental probiotic. Yogurt, unfortunately, usually doesn't get it done. It usually only has one, two, maybe a handful of probiotics in there. You need a good spread. And we're talking about billions of different bugs in there that need to help out the GI system properly. But then the leaky gut does affect all kinds of different areas of the body. Once that autoimmune response has been triggered, it can affect one or more of any of these. And you can see the thyroid gland is one of the biggies over there. Again, that's Hashimoto's thyroiditis, or Graves' thyroid, which is the hyperactive version of it. So yeah, it can go either way. It can affect the joints, it can affect the adrenal gland. So leaky gut, again, the gut is a very, very intimately connected part of the hormonal system. So I don't want to overlook that. So again, you know, part of fixing that is the bone broth protein. So just so y'all are aware of that, it does help to promote healthy gut integrity, reduces the permeability and inflammation, supports the normal immune system function. So a lot of good benefits there for that. But you can make it on your own, as you said. It's just for a lot of people, it's less of a hassle to get it than the cancer. Okay, that's the thyroid. So we got the adrenals, we got the thyroid. Next, we're going to go through estrogen balance. So this is essential for both men and women's health. And a lot of times we don't think about estrogen relation to men, but it is still a critical hormone in men as well. Too much estrogen, a condition called estrogen dominance, can cause toxic fat gain. So your body literally starts to store the fat. Water retention, bloating, and fatigue. Premenopausal women will present as pear-shaped. Postmenopausal women and men will typically present more apple-shaped with the fat deposition. Estrogen dominance, the symptoms. You probably know what some of these are, right? Especially the ladies out there, but PMS, premenstrual syndrome, the moodiness, the short triggers, you know, really just not feeling very well about the day or life in general. Varicose veins, uterine fibroids, endometriosis, ovarian cysts, insomnia, sluggish metabolism, tenderness of the breast, high emotional sensitivity. So again, just doesn't seem like a pleasant thing for anyone to be dealing with, right? I would say the greatest link of estrogen dominance, though, and the greatest factor to consider would be the increased link to cancer. All sorts of different cancers linked to estrogen dominance, prostate cancer, testicular cancer, and again, this is one of the reasons why this is also an important one to track for men, breast, uterine, cervical, and ovarian cancers for women. So again, you know, can affect men and women with estrogen dominance being the critical component here. Estrogen is antagonistic to thyroid hormone. This is also another key factor in that, remember we talk about the symphony of hormones, antagonistic means this. The higher your estrogen dominance, the lower it pushes the effectiveness of your thyroid hormone. So you may not actually have a thyroid issue at all if it is in fact an estrogen issue that's that dominant. Does that make sense? Okay, so again, your thyroid levels test out low, they put you on Synthroid, they do nothing about the estrogen issue, you start taking estrogen cream down the road, but now you also think that you had a thyroid issue to start with, so now you're taking both of these things for how long? Typically for the rest of your life from that point forward, right? So this is why it's so important to make sure that we are testing for the cause and addressing the cause rather than just you know, just treating the symptom. So again, you know, when it pushes the thyroid that low, hypothyroidism, that's caused more by estrogen dominance, is where you get some of the thinning of the hair that can occur. And I know multiple of you have talked to me about that. We know it's a hormonal response. You take a shower and you see your hair falling out, right, going down the drain. That could be an estrogen issue. Fatigue, decreased metabolism, cold hands and feet, premenstrual headaches right before your cycle. Each month you're getting a headache. That can be another sign of an estrogen imbalance. So how do we lower excess estrogen naturally? Well, again, there's a GI component. There's a gastrointestinal component. So you want to strengthen the gut through the fermentation foods that we talked about, getting that healthy gut bacteria. Another interesting finding that I found is raw broccoli. 3 to 5 servings a week of raw broccoli contains something, the active ingredient there is sulforaphane. And sulforaphane has been shown to have a direct effect on helping to lower those estrogen levels. So make sure that you're getting broccoli in regularly if this is you. Organic, naturally raised meats. So again, avoid those hormone additives because a lot of times that will throw off the estrogen hormones. We're going to talk about that here in a second. It's something called a xenoestrogen, which is mimicking the hormone estrogen, but it has the same effect. And so that can also throw things off. Eliminate those xenoestrogens, which primarily come from plastics, cosmetics, and even birth control pills can throw this off as well. Soy. Avoid the soy. If you listen to the radio show, then you heard that one, right? Phytoestrogen, which is also genetically modified. Soy, well, over 85% of the soy that's produced in the United States is genetically modified. So number one, they don't modify it for your health, okay? They modify it so they can spray it with more pesticides, which is where, you know, the xenoestrogens and the hormone mimickers come in. This is one of the reasons why we're seeing in younger and younger and younger populations of our female, where we're seeing that they're hitting puberty at earlier and earlier stages in life. It has a lot to do with the chemical exposure, what's called these xenoestrogens, and then they're getting it from hormones injected into the meat, they're getting it from the soy, the phytoestrogens in the soy. So there's just a perfect storm of factors there that are leading up to that hormone disturbance. Another important consideration in lowering estrogen naturally is sleep. Again, poor sleep habits reduce melatonin, that buffers estrogen and actually creates the dominance. Detoxification, strengthen the liver. The liver is responsible for breaking down excess estrogen. So you wanna make sure that you're getting good estrogen breakdown. This is something that's called methylation. That's the methylation process. I find that a lot of people that suffer with hormonal issues are poor methylators naturally. So the product that we have is the methylation donor product in the office is something called MORS, M-O-R-S. It's just a methylation donor. I actually take that. It helps to protect your DNA and your genetics. And I found through some testing that I actually have genetic tendencies for obesity. And 3 of my 4 genes for obesity were turned on. And so without that proper methylation, despite my best efforts to diet and exercise and do all the things that, you know, I try to do to maintain a healthy lifestyle, get adjusted, all that, my body could still put on weight just because I have the genetic predisposition for it to go that way. So methylators can be an important factor in turning those genes off to make sure that the things that you're doing can work. And so since I've started taking that methylator, you know, I've literally dropped, you know, 15 pounds in the last 2.5 weeks just by turning those obesity genes off again. So that is a critical component. That's something that's fairly new to me as well, and just understanding all of that. We talked about the exercise component, the Max T3 DVD. 3 times a week increases human growth hormone and testosterone. Both of those naturally lower estrogen. So again, there's this indirect balance there that happens. I wanted to get into a little bit more about the xenoestrogens. These are the estrogen mimickers. They mimic the same response that estrogen would, even though they're not actually estrogen. And the problem with that is that you get, you know, increased estrogen response. So you still get all the symptoms and signs and the risk factors that we talked about with estrogen dominance, but you're not actually producing too much estrogen. So really this is a toxicity issue, and we have to decrease the amount of toxins in the body. So a detox may be the appropriate recommendation if that's the case. So endocrine disrupting compounds, these are industrially made chemical compounds that disrupt communication of the body's endocrine and hormone producing organs. The two most common are, again, plastics and soy. So those would be the two things to eliminate. And then if you have been exposed to those a lot, you know, over time, then you would want to detoxify. So do either the maximized living detox or the bind and cell, bind and G-cell combination to help trap those, you know, estrogens and eliminate them from your body. You can also find xenoestrogens in other places as well. Coffee, non-organic coffee, I found was a big source of them. So this, again, is an important reason to make sure that you are purchasing organic. Canola oil, which I had a patient actually bring in a very interesting sheet. I wish I would have brought it tonight. How one of the nurse practitioners for her work was touting the amazing health benefits of canola oil. And I just gasped, you know? Because this is and they also are claiming now that canola oil is a naturally created oil, which is absolutely not true. It is chemically derived, and it comes from the rapeseed, but they're saying that it comes from something called the canola seed now. There is no such thing, so I don't even know where they come up with this stuff. So, but anyways, that's another source of xenoestrogens. Commercially raised beef and chicken, so again, because they're injected with the hormones and the antibiotic residues, that can also cause this estrogen mimicking effect. Pesticides and herbicides. So anytime we're consuming genetically modified organisms, they're going to be heavily sprayed with chemical pesticides and herbicides, and that's one of the reasons why we kind of steer you guys away from that, is because we want to make sure that you're not going to have the hormonal impact that we're seeing here. Experts estimate the average American ingests over 5 pounds of pesticides a year. Do you think that you consume that many pesticides? That's a lot, right? Could you imagine just day after day just drinking a cup full of pesticides until you reach 5 pounds? But we're getting them from all these different food sources. They're so heavily sprayed. Did you hear the latest in the news, the big merger that's happening now? Or trying to happen? Our friend Bayer Pharmaceuticals and our friend Monsanto, right? And they want to merge together and create one big evil corporation, I guess. Not that I'm against corporations at all, but I mean, if you look at the history of those two companies in particular, they've done some pretty evil things to humanity, so I think that would be a bad deal. I hope it gets blocked. But anyhow, estrogen healing. Let's talk about the supplements to fix this. So if you're having estrogen dominance for a man, you want to take the M+, the male endocrine balancing system. So that supplement will help. For women, it's the F+. Now, if you're a male and you have prostate issues on top of that, you want to take the M+ the MPC. Take both of those. This one specifically helps to address the prostate issues. If you're a woman and you're having hormonal disruption, and it's also severe PMS issues as well with your monthly cycle, then you would want to take the FPMS as well. Okay? And again, this is all in your summary sheet on that orange sheet as well. All right, the big topic that I think a lot of people came out to for tonight, this whole hot flashes thing, right? The menopause. Symptoms appear to be more aggressive and extreme in our culture versus others. I don't know if you're aware of that, but women suffer much more intensely here in America than they do in other cultures with this issue. There's a natural decline in hormone production starting between ages 45 and 55. The adrenal glands also make estrogen, which is great news if they're functioning correctly. So that can help to defray some of the intensity of the symptoms that you may experience. But if your adrenal glands are unhealthy, you're probably going to have that much more dramatic of an effect when you hit menopause. So symptoms, you know what they are, ladies. If you've been through this or you have a friend that's been through it, you've probably heard about it endlessly now, right? So tons and tons and tons of uncomfortable times there with the hot flashes. So some of the things that can help with this, there's a lot of herbs and minerals and botanicals that can help to calm the response and make it a lot less intense. In fact, I'm going to share with you a specific product tonight that contains all of these different things in one product, one bottle. And I've had probably a half dozen ladies that have been struggling with intense hot flashes within the last month or so, and I've put them all on this product, and they've reported dramatic reduction in the symptoms. So they've come back raving for it, and absolutely it has helped. So the DIM supports estrogen metabolism, so that's that estrogen breakdown. This is actually a liver support. Men will also see optimal testosterone to estrogen ratios when they take DIM. B-complex, especially vitamin B6 and B12, actually help to promote proper cell differentiation. So the hormones are going to break down into different, you know, you start with cholesterol is the main precursor to our hormones, and it's going to differentiate into testosterone or estrogen or DHEA or cortisol, and the B's help to coordinate that differentiation process to make sure there's balance. So that's really important. Folate is going to be making sure that we have proper methylation. Chrisin is an estrogen metabolizer, so again, that's that breakdown. Magnesium, supporting bone and hormonal health. Calcium, which is an estrogen metabolizer. Black cohosh, I've had a lot of patients report success with that, particularly in hot flashes, so black cohosh. Turmeric, rosemary, and grapeseed extracts are hormone antioxidants, so they help protect proper function of the hormone. And then we talked about sulforaphane, which was in broccoli, which is a super powerful antioxidant, and that helps with some of this hormonal disruption as well. So here's the product that actually has all of those in one bottle for you. If you go out and try and purchase a bottle for each one of those, it's going to get pretty out of control expense-wise, but you can get the FemGuard Plus Balance in the office, and that actually has every single one of those nutrients properly assimilated and balanced in there. And again, patients that have really reported great results, especially with the hot flashes. So if you're struggling with that, you would consider this one. Okay, yes, ma'am. That's a great question that I do not remember off the top of my head. Diandromethane. Oh, here you go. Diandromethane. Yeah. It may smell a little bit. All right, testosterone, dominant male sex hormone. Again, this is both important for men and women. Men, normal free levels are between 30 and 142, but for women, normal free levels are only 6 to 49. So you can see it's a much lower concentration for women than it is for men. So you don't have to worry about, you know, women, I think a lot of times we tell them to go and do strength training in the gym and work out, and they're worried about producing too much testosterone and getting too bulked up. It's literally physiologically impossible for your body to do that unless you're trying to actually really push it outside of these normal values. So it's very rare that you'll see the body self-regulate outside of that. In fact, you know, many times where you see these bodybuilder women with the muscles stacked on top of the muscles, they have to put their body in an abnormal physiological state to do that. So there's supplementation and maybe steroids, testosterone injection that they're doing. So you really don't have to worry about that within the normal human physiology processes. There is something called andropause, however. Has anyone heard of this before? This is the male version of menopause. It's called manopause, right? Decline in testosterone, it's more gradual than menopause, usually about a 1 to 2% reduction per year. It's where the levels dip below that 30 picograms per milliliter. So again, you want them to be between 30 and 142. Once they dip below that 30 level, that's where we start getting the menopause symptoms. Plays a role in the 10 most common causes of death for men, which would include, stroke, diabetes, Alzheimer's, cancer, heart diseases. Play a role in almost all of these disease processes. Testosterone is that important for male health. So it's something that you definitely want to be keeping track of. I always tell my patients, when you're getting your yearly blood test, make sure you get your vitamin D3 levels, get your testosterone levels. You know, let's see where you're at. As always, you want to address the cause. So if you do know that you have low testosterone, here's how we start to treat that naturally. first and foremost, let's make the lifestyle changes, address the grains, the gluten, and the sugars, because all of those are inflammatory and they push down the testosterone levels. So you want to eliminate those grains and gluten and sugars immediately. Make sure that you get your vitamin D3 levels in an optimal range, which ideally should be somewhere between 80 and 100. Well, the medical testing says if it's anything above 30, then you're good to go. You know, it really needs to be up on the higher end of that. So 80 to 100 is where you're actually gonna see the benefits in regards to your hormones, to your immune system, not just your bone structure. So 30 it'll save you from rickets, you know, but that's pretty much about it. If you wanna get all the other great, amazing benefits of vitamin D, just need to make sure they're in the upper ranges of the normal. Your fitness, your burst strength, which is the max T3, those naturally stimulate a human growth hormone and testosterone response. So doing that high intensity workout that we talked about, that definitely helps. Getting adjusted, so making sure that the spine is in proper alignment. And that's not just for men, that helps balance out the whole complement of hormones that I'm gonna show you the link there in just a second. Make sure that you have proper thyroid and adrenal health. So, you know, low testosterone ultimately connected, again, that symphony of hormones. Test the adrenals, test the thyroid, make sure there's no underlying causes of concern there, because certainly that can be part of the problem. And then sleep. You know, I can't stress sleep enough, right? Sleep and gut health, those have been two over and over resounding repetitions that we've gone through tonight. But listen to how much sleep affects testosterone levels in particular. A 10 to 15% decline in testosterone with just 1 week of 5 hours per night or less of sleep, compared to a 1 or 2% drop per year otherwise. So it's a huge difference. So if you're not sleeping correctly, maybe that's an adrenal issue that you need to have addressed or a thyroid issue that needs to be addressed, you need to figure that out, because that's definitely gonna affect your testosterone production over time in a very dramatic fashion. So what's it worth to you? So I just looked it up, because you know the big thing, have you guys seen that, you know, all these low T commercials, and you get the cream, get the injection, you know, all this stuff. So I just looked it up out of curiosity, even though, you know, we know that that's not getting to the cause, and basically you would have to take the cream or the injection for how long? You'd have to take that for the rest of your life to keep your testosterone levels up. Yes, it's gonna make you feel better. Yes, it's gonna give you more energy. Yes, it's gonna make you feel like, you know, you're much younger again, but it's a synthetic response. You know, that's there's actually a lot of risk that comes with that as well, because you're not fixing the cause. So you're still at all the risk for those diseases, because you don't have the systems working correctly under the surface. So you're still at higher risk for strokes and heart attacks and diabetes and all the other things that we talked about here. However, your body's now addicted to this testosterone, synthetic testosterone cream or injection. And the reason for that, again, is that negative feedback loop. Remember how we talked about that with the hypothalamus and the pituitary, right? So here's the cost of low T therapy. $395 a month, which came out to, you know, just over $4,700 a year. That's the cash option. So down there in the fine print, it actually says this is the self-pay price for us not to bill your insurance, right? So if you actually want to run through insurance, I don't even know how much it costs. This was the cash fee structure. I think that we could probably get to the cause and solve it for a lot more costing, you know, a lot better cost effectiveness than what you're seeing up here. So, but we definitely want to find the cause of the problem and get there. So the testosterone support, again, this has got a bunch of different herbal combinations in it that really help to boost the testosterone. It's something called libido stem, you know, great supplement for helping. So if you have erectile dysfunction or other symptoms as a result of the low testosterone, this would be the supplement that you would go to as a result to help stimulate those processes. All right, we've talked a little bit about hormone replacement therapy, but I'll get into it in just a little bit more depth. Again, not only does it doesn't decrease the risk of the heart disease, the strokes, and the Alzheimer's, it actually increases those risks, according to John Abramson, who's a medical doctor out of Harvard. So the hormone replacement is not the answer, and I know it's the quick fix, and in our society, in our culture, we like to go to the quick fix often. But you really do need to get to the cause and get this properly taken care of. Listen to this one as well. Women's risk of breast cancer increases 8%, which each year of hormone replacement therapy. Each year. So, you know, let's say 10 years out, right? That's an 80% increase of breast cancer. No wonder we're seeing breast cancer running rampant right now in our society. And that's out of Journal of American Medical Association. So that's a medical journal. Came out in 2000. So that's been around for quite some time. How many of you are aware of the risk of hormone replacement therapy to increase breast cancer, right? A handful of people. So yeah, that's an important thing to understand. This one I've always thought is very interesting as well. How many have heard of premarin before? Okay, does anybody know where premarin comes from? Here's a hint. Yeah, horses. After years of steady increase, breast cancer rates dropped 7% in 2003, 1 year after millions of women stopped taking hormone replacement therapy, following a report by Women's Health Initiative regarding the dangers of the hormone replacement therapy. So the source of this is horse urine. Pregnant mare urine is what premarin stands for. And to me, that just doesn't sit well with me to know that I would be taking horse urine. So yeah, absolutely, you would want to get to the cause. But if you didn't know that, right, then you may be taking this not knowing otherwise. So other problems, again, it causes a disruption. Disrupts the orchestration of the hormonal pathways. The conversion goes right into the bloodstream as a free hormone. So when you're taking hormone replacement therapy, again, you're getting direct thyroid hormone. You're getting direct estrogen. You're getting direct testosterone. It doesn't go through the proper hormone replacement process, or excuse me, doesn't go through the proper hormone conversion process, and that messes up the whole cycle of natural systems that your body's developed. And so those negative feedback loops get activated, and now your body makes naturally makes less and less and less of those hormones in response to having the synthetic chemical in there in its place. Does that make sense? Okay, so you're really shutting those systems off completely, and sometimes you can never get them started back up. So that's kind of the concern there. And then finally, production, and then that's that negative feedback system. It causes less and less production by the body over time. So then it actually creates an addiction. You have to have these hormone replacements just for your body to try and function correctly. And the transition of coming off of them and trying to get in the cause and do something natural just makes that process that much more difficult. It's not that it can't be done. It definitely can be. It just makes it that transition that much more difficult. So get to the cause. Don't just treat the symptoms. So again, here's your summary. That's also on your orange sheet. So if you have the adrenal fatigue, it has the supplements for that. Adrenal overdrive, supplementation for that. Hypothyroid, Hashimoto's, menopause, manopause, sleep issues, prostate issues, balance, and men's balance of hormones. So we gave you the summary of all of those, just so you would know if you did want to start attacking these at the root cause tonight. You already have a diagnosed problem. You want to get after it, go ahead. Order your supplements up. Let's start getting going. Make some of those lifestyle modifications like the sleep. Get the high-intensity interval training exercise going. Make sure you're changing some of the food components that we talked about tonight and get the supplements in to start healing these systems. So all of this, though, you can literally toss out the window if this next part isn't already being addressed. So again, we talk about the connection between the human frame. What is it that controls all hormonal function in your entire body? What does that? It's the brain, right? Specifically, it's the hypothalamus of the brain. And so if the brain regulates and controls all the hormonal processes in your body, if you've never actually had your nervous system checked to make sure that your brain is properly communicating with the rest of the organ systems of your body, that's where we need to start. Because if that system's not healing and functioning correctly, you can do all the lifestyle changes in the world and still not see your recovery, still not see the healing that you deserve. And so we want to make sure that you follow the hierarchy of healing. Number one, have the right mindset. You want to get to the cause, make the lifestyle transformation that you need to actually get well. Number two, address the spine. The spine and the nervous system. The nervous system is king. The nervous system controls every organ, cell, and tissue in your entire body. If you're not getting regular chiropractic care to make sure the nervous system is functioning correctly, then it's likely not. You know, and I can't tell you how many times I've found that in patients. You do not have to have pain to have neurological interference. You do not have to have pain to have neurological interference. So many people make that mistake. They think, well, I don't have a pinched nerve, I don't have any pain. That's not true. You can still have nerve interference without having pain. And so you have to have it checked. Serotonin controls the fight or flight response and regulates cortisol. Serotonin levels are affected by the atlas, which is the very top bone in the neck. And if that's misaligned, that's called subluxation. That has a direct impact on your serotonin. It's going to have a direct impact on your cortisol, which is going to affect the adrenal glands. We made that connection today. Loss of cervical curve. So when we look at your spine from the side, it should actually have a banana-shaped curve here in the neck. That leads to pathological tension of the spinal cord and the brainstem. We talked about where the hypothalamus sits, right? Right up there in the brainstem. So it's extremely important for us to make sure that all of those neurological functions are balanced out. There's no structural interference, and that's functioning correctly. In fact, it's many times been called the neuroendocrine system because there is such an intimate connection between the nerve function and the endocrine function. What controls the hormones? Nerve system. Each adjustment provides better hormone balance and function just simply by reconnecting the brain to the function of the body and making sure that that system is clear. Keep this in mind. For many people, by the time that the hormonal dysfunction occurs, it took 40, 50, 60 years for these systems to get out of balance. So the level of producing symptoms. So how long should it take for me to get it back in balance for you? It's not going to take another 60 years, okay? So take a breath there. But it's going to take time, right? Every process of healing takes time, especially if you're getting to the cause. You just have to be willing to put the work in to do that. So again, here's the connection. Normal cervical curve in the neck. You can see this nice curve here. You can see it on the cadaver as well. No tension on the spinal cord, nice and loose. There's your hypothalamus right there in the brainstem, right? So the brain's going to produce the signal. Hormonal cascade that affects the endocrine gland. So hypothalamus produces a hormone that affects the endocrine gland that produces a hormone that then affects the target tissue. Let's say it's the thyroid, right? What happens when you're subluxated? So see this spine shifted out of alignment now versus this one? You got your nice banana-shaped curve here. In our next one, that curve's actually reversed into the wrong direction. I find this unfortunately happening in younger and younger and younger populations now. What do you think's causing it? We call it technology neck now, right? Cell phones, iPads, computer work all day long. These are micro traumas that add up over time. Years and years and years of this starts causing a structural deformity in the spine, and that disrupts this proper pattern. So now the brain still sends out the hormones, right? But now those hormones aren't getting through to get to the target gland, to get to the actual tissue. And so the hormonal response is disrupted right from the start, right from the primary source. And so the way that we correct that is with chiropractic care. We start to change the structural deformity, pull the pressure off the brainstem and off the nervous system, allow the power to flow back through, proper hormonal responses can occur. So. This is a very complicated version of how the nervous system works, but what I want you to see, and somebody went and did all the research and put all this together into a nice little diagram for you, what I want you to see is that up here it starts with the brain, and when the brain is subluxated, either through traumas, thoughts, or toxins, then that subluxation affects all these different parts of the nervous system. And you'll see that there's the adrenal medulla that literally sits right inside the adrenal gland, okay? That gets directly affected by subluxation. You'll also see way over here the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus directly affected by subluxation. So again, it is just that important to make sure. You can see all the hormonal connections then. Anxiety, depression, let's see what else we got in here. Autoimmune issues is one that we talked about. Weight gain, we talked about fatigue, we talked about with your trouble sleeping. There's a lot of different responses there as a result of an improperly functioning nervous system. So if you are a guest tonight, you have not had that check, make sure that you get that check tonight. That is your first step in the hierarchy of healing. Talk to one of the team members in the back. Team members, raise your hand. They can help you get set up with an initial evaluation. Our new patient special for the month of September is just $127. For your first three visits of evaluation in the office, We will do a posture check, a nerve scan, and any x-rays to determine the structural interference on the nerve system, and then put together a protocol of correction there. If you're a current patient, make sure that you're making your adjustment schedule. Make sure that you're doing your home rehabs. I know there's a tendency to fall off track with that. This is a good reminder, another reinforcement why you need to be doing your home rehab daily as well, okay? Can everybody do that? All right, very good. Okay, so if you're a guest, go ahead and get that checked. If you're a patient, you'd like to order up supplements, make sure you have your green sheet filled out completely. Hand that into a team member. We'll make sure that gets turned into the appropriate office. We'll get those supplements ordered for your pickup and have those in as soon as possible for you to get started on these protocols. Other than that, I will take some time to field questions individually. Mm-hmm. How are we doing on time? Yeah, we're about 10 minutes over, so I'm going to go ahead and release those of you that have to go. Anyone else that has individual questions?